Thank you, Marlene. Welcome, everybody. We welcome you on this drizzly Sunday night. The sun is not outside, but it's on the inside, correct? S-O-N, shine. Amen. We have the sunshine of the Lord Jesus. We welcome you tonight, and to all of you who have joined us online, we welcome you. We're thankful you've joined with us. I would remind you that we're going to celebrate the Lord's table at the end of our service, so you might want to get your elements ready so that you can come and join with us as well. We'd be happy to have you do that. Let me share some announcements with us before we go to prayer and Pastor Jared comes to read God's word for us. We have a lot going on here at TFB during the month of December. Next Sunday morning at our morning service, 10:30, we have our children's choir bringing their Christmas musical. I know that you will enjoy it. I pray that you'll come and join us at 10:30. And then on the 18th, our adult choir will also bring their Christmas cantata, and we trust that you will come and join with us. It's always a wonderful time to worship the Lord with music, and we trust you'll be here. Then on Christmas Eve, Saturday, December the 24th, at 5 o'clock here in the worship center, we have our candlelight Christmas Eve service. And this is a wonderful time. It's a family time. We trust if you're available, please come and join with us. I know that you will be encouraged, and that will prepare your heart for the next day. And then, of course, Sunday, Christmas Day, we'll have our 10:30 service in the morning, and it won't be long, but it'll be very meaningful. We want it to be a family worship service as we worship our Lord. There will be no life groups in the morning, no evening service, either on Christmas night or New Year's night, so I just let you know that in advance. Also, this coming Saturday at 10:30, we have Linda Passione's husband's service, Ralph Passione's service at 10:30. And many of you knew her, maybe not him, but we pray that as a support for her, you'd come and be with her and the family at this time. I know that would be deeply appreciated. And then tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock, we want to pray for Tammy as she's having foot surgery at TMH. So let's remember Tammy at 1 tomorrow afternoon.
Roger, yes. That was set back to Tuesday.
Okay, so we pray Tuesday.
Yes.
We can still pray Monday, but Tuesday's the actual surgery. Okay, we can do that. All right. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you now for the privilege that we have to come before you tonight with thanksgiving, with singing, with joy in our hearts. And as we gather together, we just are humbly asking you, Lord God, just to meet with us in a very real and special way. We pray, Heavenly Father, for Tammy as she has this surgery on Tuesday. We pray for guidance for the doctors, and we pray that that surgery will go well and that this will help her tremendously in her ongoing time of getting well. And so we entrust her to you. And then we pray for Linda and her family as we have Ralph's service on Saturday. Lord, it's been a joy to meet with her and to talk with her. We continue to ask for your encouragement and your strength for her and for the family. And we pray that as many people gather, that their hearts would be open to your word, Lord God. We thank you now. We praise you. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Pastor Jared.
Amen. Amen. Now, some of you might have seen in the back or up on the tree some ornaments that look like these. They have on them names of Christ. This one says Emmanuel. This one says the Christ. What we're doing this season is we're using these and we're putting prayer requests on the back. So if you grab one from the back, or you can even look up here, there's empty ones on the tree, and you can write a prayer request and put it on the tree, and then somebody will pray for it. Or if you want to pray for someone else, you can go to the tree and find one that has a prayer request on it and take that and pray for that person as well. So it's a way to what's that? And you don't have to put your name. No, absolutely. You don't have to put your name. It can be anonymous, whatever you want. But we just want to make sure that we're covering this season in prayer, especially drawing on the power of the name of Jesus. Amen? Amen. So let's go ahead and read our scripture today. It's from John 18, 36 and 37. It says this, Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." And then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king." And Jesus answered, "You say that I'm a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I've come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. And everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." And that's why we're here. To listen to his voice. Now let's come and praise him.
I'm ready to sing some carols. Amen. Anybody else?
Yes.
Good. All right, let's turn to the first one, 270, Joy to the World.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Verse 2. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ. While fields and floods, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. Verse 4. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love.
All right, it's time to greet one another, please. The next carol we're going to sing is 259, Angels from the Realms of Glory, 259. And we'll sing verses 1, 4, and 5. 1, 4, and 5.
Angels from the realms of glory, bring your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Verse 4. Saints before the altar bending, watching long in hope and fear. Suddenly the Lord descending in his temple shall appear. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Though an infant, now we view him, he who shares his father's throne, gathered all the nations to him, every knee shall be bowed down.
so familiar with that last verse, are we?
No.
All right, let's sing the next one. 251, 251, It Came Upon the Midnight Clear. Verses 1 and 4.
It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of all. From angels bending near the earth to touch the harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men. From heaven's all gracious King, the world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. Verse 4. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets seen foretold. With the ever-certain years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendor fling, and the whole world shall back the song which now the angels sing.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Now, I practice the names of these countries, but I'm surely going to mess up. So I'm hoping if I say it slow enough, it'll be okay. We're focusing on Central Asia, and I just want to share where they stand in terms of the World Watch list. Uzbekistan is 21st place. Turkmenistan is the 25th place. Tajikistan is 45th. And Kazakhstan is 47th place. And these are Islamic countries. And in our prayer focus, it speaks about how family turn against you. And that's what we find in former Muslim turning to Christ. They often experience horrific persecution from their own family. But I found that in our prayer on December 5th, spoke about this young lady who had to testify before the village, and God helped her, and the villagers stood with her when she was confronted with an abusive husband. So there are encouraging news as well as difficult times. The other thing that I also found in researching is the persecution is not always from the older generation to the younger. You can have family believers who like the parents' age, and they get abused. Like the particular case I was looking at from Uzbekistan, the mother was put in a mental hospital with forced medication because she believes in Christ. And the daughter was able to convey the authorities and the people around her that she's crazy. So we see abuse at the hands of family, but God is more than enough. I was thinking about what Dad, Pastor Zach, taught us last week when we were thinking about Jesus created a miracle for a man who was born blind. And the scripture was given also in the face of persecution was Matthew 11. And he spoke about Jesus called for us to come and rest. So I'd like to use that passage to pray for us. So the promise of rest that comes from Jesus. Say, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And that's from Matthew 11, starting with verse 28 to 30. Let's pray for the Central Asia believers. Abba, Father, we thank you for the giving of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for the giving of your life, that you're in your complete work on the cross. We stand in righteousness. We stand forgiven. We are yoked with you. And so, Lord, I just pray for the believer in Central Asia, the despair and the burden and the weariness that they must face in times of persecution. Would you indeed give them rest? And I was thinking about how would you give rest? It's that place in which you give your perfect peace and you fill them with love and affirmation. You give them the ability to forgive. So, Lord, I do pray for the family members who are opposing these believers, that you'll give them the light as you created the miracle of eyes to see in that blind man. Would you give them spiritual eyes to see that in Jesus there is salvation and no other name, and that they can turn from their errors and turn to you. And I also ask that you give the believers in Central Asia, Father, the continual boldness to proclaim your gospel, as we have seen that young woman in the face of sharing why she believed in Christ with her villagers. And I'm asking, too, that those who are suffering in much despair and weariness of the heart, the mind, and the physical body and the soul, that you give them your perfect peace, peace that give them rest and contentment, knowing that you are with them through every aspect of it. Thank you for your comfort. Thank you for your presence that makes a difference in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mary, did you know? What an awesome song, what an awesome thought for us to contemplate as we come to this Christmas season. I do want to put out a shout out, as we say, to Robert and you, Norman. They let us know that they're watching us online. Just an update on Robert. He is home. He is making progress. We're very thankful to the Lord for what he's done for him. Noon and family are feeling better as well. So greetings, dear people, and we're so glad that you're feeling better, and we're praying for complete healing for all of you. And then also we mentioned that last Sunday, the Lord took home one of our own, Rita Varoff, and Neville and Irene heard today that the service is going to be up in Camarillo. It'll be on the 21st of December. We don't have any other news at this time, but we just make that known to you. And if some are wanting to go, maybe we can make a way for that to happen. But I just want to let you know it's December the 21st for Rita's memorial service. Well, would you kindly take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 9 for me. John chapter 9, as we continue in our series in the Gospel of John. I chose the passage of Scripture that Pastor Jared read because of many reasons, but there was one word in the verses that was very important. The Lord Jesus talked about people who would listen to him. And tonight, my message title is, They Would Not Listen, speaking of the Pharisees who were coming against him and the man that was born blind and now was made healed. You know, there's an old expression which says, you can lead a horse to water, but you cannot what? Make it drink. That's true. I'd like to also say you can invite a person to listen, but it's up to them to have an open mind. You can invite a person to listen, but it's up to them to have an open mind. As we once again look into John chapter 9, we see the religious leaders of Israel not having an open mind to what the Lord Jesus was saying and doing. These religious leaders did not want to admit that the man that they were interviewing had not been born blind, and that it certainly wasn't Jesus who did it, because they were jealous of him. But on the other hand, they wanted people to know that Jesus had done something wrong by healing this man. So tonight we're going to look into this passage of Scripture and finish the chapter and see how important it is for us to listen to the Lord Jesus as he speaks to us through his wonderful word. So as we start tonight, would you kindly look with me, John chapter 9 at verse 24. I'm going to read verses 24 and 25 for us now. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and said to him, Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, Whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I know, that though I was blind, now I see. What a powerful testimony of the grace and the power of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, as we come to you tonight, and we come to you in your word, we're inviting you to speak to our hearts. May we open the doors of our spiritual hearts, as it were, and invite you to come in, to have fellowship with us, to speak to us. And Heavenly Father, may we listen. We're so thankful that at this Christmas season, we have so much more than buying gifts and partying and going to places. We have a Savior, we have a God to worship, one who lives forever, and one who has chosen to live in our hearts and lives as we place our faith in him. So Heavenly Father, we praise you tonight, and we thank you so much for your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Speak to us now, Lord, and we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen. Amen. Our theme once again, they would not listen. As we look into the gospel account of John, we see that throughout the gospel that these Pharisees were shaped by thoughts that had a faulty understanding of who Jesus was. They saw Jesus preach. They saw him do miracles. And yet they had this faulty understanding of who he was. Simply stated, they did not believe that he was the Messiah of Israel. But how wonderful it would have been had these religious leaders taken at face value the message that the blind man who'd now been healed, if they'd taken at face value what had happened to him and placed their faith in Christ, but they did not. And instead, they grilled him the second time regarding his healing, and they gave him a command, give glory to God. This phrase oftentimes was asking somebody to admit that they were a sinner, that they had done wrong. And so they were asking this man, give glory to God, say that it was this man, Jesus, who sinned by doing this miracle on the Sabbath. They weren't so much concerned about the breaking of the law on the Sabbath because it was right to do good on the Sabbath, but they were upset that they had been violated because their traditions were threatened, their influence among the people would somehow be lessened. As you look at these men through the Gospels, we see that they indeed were jealous of who Jesus was and jealous of what he could do. The people were flocking to him. They were flocking to him because of who he was, this gracious, wonderful man, this new rabbi who was ministering to them. And thankfully, many were placing their faith in him as the Son of God and the Messiah of Israel. Jesus had not done anything wrong to these Pharisees. Nothing. He'd done nothing wrong against the law. He healed the blind man, and he simply was relating the truth that he had the power of doing these things for the glory of his Father's name. But as I looked at this passage of Scripture and saw what the healed man had said to the Pharisees, it occurred to me that this man gave all of us who believed in Christ a very concise personal testimony when somebody asks us, why do you believe in Jesus? What he has done for you? And in verse 25 of John 9, the man said, one thing I know, that though I was blind, now I what? Now I see. I was blind. I was physically blind. But now I see. And for those of us who have placed our faith in Christ, we can share we were spiritually blind, but now through faith in Jesus, we see. What a wonderful testimony. Sometimes we wonder, what words can I say? That's a very concise testimony. I was blind, my friend, but now through faith in Christ, I see. Well, how powerful it was that this man, this newly sighted man, could make such a challenge to these men. Dr. David Jeremiah says this about this. He says, this newly sighted man challenged Jesus' opponents with his I know declaration. His experience was not secondhand faith, but the result of a direct encounter with God. He came into contact with God, and God had made him real. God had made himself known to this man. And through faith, this man, as we're going to see, is going to have not only sight, but a new relationship with God through Christ. Earlier, these religious leaders had told us that what they really thought of the Lord Jesus, in the most crass language possible, they said in John 8:41, to the Lord Jesus, we were not born of sexual immorality, to which the Lord Jesus responded to them, and which one of you convicts me of sin? Of course, not any one of them, not then, not now, could convict the Lord Jesus of any sin. He is sinless. He has done nothing wrong. And because he had done nothing wrong, there was absolutely no reply. These men were left without words. But then in verse 27 of John 9, this healed man now turns the tables on these hypocritical religious leaders. And in what has been called biting sarcasm, he suggests that they too now desire to be disciples of Jesus because they've come to him for the second time to find out how he was made to see. Their response to him was quick, it was harsh. And in verse 28 of John 9, they respond, they reviled him, saying, you are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. That word revile, it's a heavy word. It's an angry word. It means to mock, to jeer, or to laugh to scorn. In the harshest way possible, they are demeaning this man because he now had eyes that could see because of Jesus. From here, their discussion turned into a heated argument with harsh words spoken. And as far as the authorities were concerned, the healed man, in defending Jesus, meant that he was now a disciple of Jesus, and they wanted nothing to do with him, just as they wanted nothing to do with Jesus. And they censoriously judged this man. Well, would you now look with me, please, at verse 29 of John chapter 9. Let's read on. We, the religious leaders, know that God has spoken to Moses. But as far as this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, why, this is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. But if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do what? Nothing. They answered him, you were born in utter sin, and would you teach us? And they cast him out. Think of it, this seemingly ignorant man has now become the teacher to these who supposedly are men of great learning. They do not know who Jesus is. The truth of the matter is, they did not want to know. But this man is now teaching them some spiritual truths. The healed man's perception of what Jesus had done for him was opening his eyes, not these eyes, but the eyes of his heart to spiritual truth. But sadly, these religious leaders persisted in remaining blind with their spiritual sight. And although at this point, this man was not aware of Jesus' identity, that he was the Son of God, though he would be shortly, he was aware of a spiritual truth which punched holes in the religious leaders' unjust and grossly inaccurate view of Jesus. For in verse 31, he said, and this is powerful, we know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. You would not find the average man on the street standing up to the religious leaders of Israel. That is not something you did. You would be cast out of the synagogue, as we're going to see it happens to him. But this man was given the strength, was given the fortitude to say what was true. If anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. So what was the summation of this man's argument towards these religious leaders? It is this, that the one who healed him is indeed from God. Otherwise, he could not have done anything. He could not have done this miracle, which, as is stated in verse 32, has never been seen since the world began. We can only imagine what was going on in the hearts of these religious leaders as they are now being schooled by this man. He was not only born blind, but he was a beggar. He was at the bottom line of the social ladder. And to have this man now speak to them in such a way, I would imagine it took them aback. In verse 34, we see that these men had venom towards this man, venom that had been earlier directed at the Lord Jesus. These religious leaders said to him in verse 34 that he was born in utter sin. Now, how would you like to have someone say that to you? You were born in utter sin. It was derogatory. It was meant to hurt. It was meant to deep right down inside of you. These men reasoned that this man's affliction must have occurred to him because before he was born, he had done something wrong. How stupid, how irresponsible for them to say, but that was the thought of the day. How could anyone be born in utter sin at birth? To be sure, everyone is born with a sinful nature. We never discount that. David said in Psalm 51:5, "Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." And the Apostle Paul said in Romans 5 and verse 12, "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, the man Adam, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all have sinned." And after they told him that he was born in utter sin, they cast him out, which means he was excommunicated. He was not to come into the synagogue. He was not to have any spiritual life. People were to shun him. To be shunned by your family, to be shunned by the people, the friends that you knew, was a horrible thing. And this is now what has happened to this man. I chose the word venom for a purpose when I said that these religious leaders had been speaking with venom towards the Lord Jesus. And now they're speaking in venom towards this man. Why did I choose that word? I choose words carefully. This is what the word venom means in a non-reptilian way. It means this: extreme malice and bitterness shown in someone's attitudes, speech, or actions. And this is exactly what these men were showing, not only to the Lord Jesus, but now to the man who has been made whole through the power of Jesus. We ask, why were these leaders asking this way? Were they not to be those who would care for the people of Israel? Was that not their task, to teach and to help and to comfort? What then is making them act this way? Yes, Jesus had done a marvelous miracle, but these religious leaders would neither honor the Lord, nor did they want to say that this man had been made well, especially by Jesus. Once again, as we've said last week, there is a blindness worse than physical blindness, and that's spiritual blindness of the heart. And dear family, there are many, many, multiple millions, perhaps billions of people today who have spiritual blindness of the heart. It's not that they cannot see, but they choose not to see. What do we do with these dear people? We pray for them. We love them. We seek to witness to them in the power of the Spirit. Even though they have spiritual blindness, we don't want to write them off. No, absolutely not. We continue to pray. We continue to seek to love them and to help them, that they might come to an understanding of who the Lord Jesus Christ is, God the Son and Savior of the world. As I thought of these religious leaders that were now coming against Jesus and this dear man, I thought of what the writer to the Hebrews said in Hebrews 3, 12 through 19. He's helping these people to remember what was going on in the Old Testament when the people of God were turning a deaf ear his way, when they were spiritually blind of heart, and he's cautioning them. And in verse 12 of Hebrews 3, he says this: "Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God." An unbelieving heart comes from not wanting to hear what God has to say. And that's what these men in the first century AD talking with Jesus were now doing. They were not wanting to hear what the Lord Jesus was saying. As I go through God's word and as I prepare my messages, I seek to see if there's something that says something specifically to me. And as I thought of listening to Jesus, it made me reaffirm something in my own life. I want to continually be listening to Jesus. As a disciple belonging to him, I must listen to him if I want to grow spiritually, if I want to have his blessing upon my life, if I want my life to have fruitfulness in service for him. And understanding that, I found something from Oswald Chambers of My Utmost for His Highest. And he wrote something about listening that God had spoken to him about. And he says this, "What hinders me, Oswald Chambers, from hearing God is that I am taken up with other things. If I am devoted to things, to service, to convictions, God may say what he likes, but I do not hear him." What a powerful, true statement. Oh, dear family, we want to always be continually listening to Jesus. Well, these religious leaders of Israel's are exhibiting their unbelief in Christ by the way they treat the Lord and by the way they are treating this man. This is why they are acting the way they are. They have not believed in Jesus. And what a sorrow it is when somebody hears the truth, when they understand the truth, and they reject the truth. We pray for these dear ones. Well, after this sad experience with the religious leaders, what has now happened to this dear man? We must read on. Look at verse 35, John 9. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, I love this, "You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, "Are we also blind?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say, 'We see,' your guilt remains." Well, verses 1 through 34 of John 9 deal with Jesus' restoration of physical sight to this dear man. Verses 35 through 41 feature Jesus bringing this man to spiritual sight in him. Now, please notice how the Lord Jesus takes care of those who belong to him. The Lord Jesus sought this man out. The Pharisees threw him out. They wanted him gone. They didn't want anything to do with him. But that's not how the Lord Jesus takes care of his children. When things happen to us, he is the first to minister to our need. And once again, he took the initiative and he sought out this dear man and came to him. But he didn't come to him. He asked him the most important question that anybody could hear and answer. And the question was this: do you believe in the Son of Man? This was not just a simple question. This was a powerful, important question, the most important question of all. Jesus was inviting this man to place his faith in him as the one who revealed God the Father. Yes, he wanted this man to believe in him as Israel's Messiah. This was a call to total commitment, a yielding of life to it in its entirety unto Christ for now and eternity. Sir, do you believe in the Son of Man? What a question. But then notice the man's response. And who is he, sir, that I might believe in him? Once again, our Lord said these words. Try to put yourself in this man's place. You've just been manhandled by the religious leaders. You've been thrown out. And now the Lord who's healed you has sought you out. And Jesus says to him in verse 37 of John 9, "You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you." I don't know about you, but I can only imagine what must have gone on in this dear man's life to be talking face to face with the Son of God, from the one he's heard of, probably as a child, from his parents, to be in the synagogue, to be in the temple, and to hear the people tell of the prophecies of the Old Testament saints, and now to see that he's right here, right in front of him, and it was this man who literally touched him and made him whole. How glorious that must have been for that dear man. And then he says, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Remember when you received Christ? Remember when the truths of Scripture became real to you? Doesn't matter if you were 8 years old as I was, or you were 40 or 60 or 70, whatever the age was. Remember when those spiritual truths became true to you and you realized you were a sinner, but further than that, you realized that Jesus died for you. What was it going on in your mind? It was glory. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I remember as an 8-year-old little boy kneeling in the pastor's office after morning service. Dear deacon came. He had me kneel and he put a Bible on a chair in front of me. He read scripture and we talked about it. And then he put his hand over me and I prayed to receive Christ. What a glorious moment. And it was no less glorious for this dear man. All these years ago, I believe. And he worshiped him. But then notice, please, that after this, in verse 39 of John 9, the Lord Jesus speaks of judgment. Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see, in quotes, may become blind. The blind who come to sight are those who are willing to admit their helplessness, their inability to save themselves. They're willing to admit their unworthiness, put their pride aside, and trust Jesus for the forgiveness of their sins. While those who, quote, unquote, see and become blind are those who have this self-trust and pride. It blinds them to the wonders of the saving grace of God through his Son, Jesus Christ. Dr. Edwin Blum states here, Jesus does not condemn them by making them blind. They blind themselves by rejecting him, and Satan contributes to that binding. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, the Apostle Paul says, in their case, meaning those who will not believe in Jesus, the God of this world, Satan, has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. And in verse 40 of John 9, we read of a question asked by these religious leaders. Once again, some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, are we also blind? Again, Jesus said, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say, we see, your guilt remains. In verse 41, our Lord in particular referenced the sin of unbelief pertaining to him being the Messiah and the Son of God as he answered the Pharisees' questions. If only these men had acknowledged their spiritual lostness, if they would acknowledge their inability to save themselves by the things that they did, if only they would have humbled themselves before the Lord Jesus, they would no longer be guilty of sin, of the sin of unbelief. But they wouldn't do that. They wouldn't humble themselves before the Lord Jesus Christ. And still, deceiving themselves that their spiritual darkness was light, and in their continued rejection of Christ as their Messiah and Savior, they remained in their sin and their guilt. And if they died in their sin and their guilt, they would spend an eternity without God in hell, which our Heavenly Father did not want anybody to ever experience. over against these religious leaders of Israel who did this. As I thought of this blind man who was made whole physically and then whole spiritually, I was reminded of another man. Remember the thief on the cross? Both of them railed at Jesus at the beginning. And then one of the thieves heard the people speaking to Jesus, the vile things they were saying. And yet they heard the Lord Jesus cry out, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And this man was listening, even though he was on the cross and he was in severe pain. This man, at this time, was listening. And as he listened, his heart turned to Christ. And he simply said, this was speaking of faith to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And I can only imagine, what must have gone through that man's mind that day. He's on the cross. He's dying for the sins which he committed. But now he's turned his life over to Christ because he listened to him. And the Lord Jesus said these words to him, "Today you shall what? Shall be with me in paradise." He's dying a gruesome death. But that wasn't it. Today, my friend, you shall be with me in paradise. That man died a cruel death, but he died with the knowledge that he was in God's hands. Wow. Wow. And getting back to this dear man who was born blind, he realized that he was in God's hands. He'd been thrown out. It did not matter. He now belonged to Christ. Who is he, Lord? It is he who is speaking to you. Lord, I believe. Wow. What a wonderful way. What a wonderful way to end the 9th chapter of the Gospel of John. Well, this dear man left that day rejoicing. And you and I come to the table of the Lord rejoicing. He looked to the Savior who would die for his sins. We look back to the Savior who did die for our sins. And through faith in his name, we too are made spiritually whole. Amen? Amen. Dear men, would you please come as we get ready to partake of the Lord's table.
You recognize the song, don't you? Silent night, holy night. And what's the last line? Sleep in heavenly what?
Peace.
Peace. That's what Jesus came to give us. Amen. He came to give us peace. He allowed his body to be broken so that we could have peace that passes understanding. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that you have given us peace. Jesus, you have made it so that we can have a relationship with the Father. Mm-hmm. You have set us in a right relationship with yourself. You have given us peace. Lord, the world around us doesn't understand that. It doesn't know that. We live in a world that is full of strife and envy and suffering and not of peace, but yet we know that you gave us true inner peace, peace with God and peace with one another as unified members of the body of Christ. Lord, help us to share that message of peace this Christmas season with those around us who are in desperate need of that. And thank you for giving us your body to be broken as our shalom, as our peace. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That night in the upper room, he took the bread and he said, "This is my body. Please take and eat."
When we think of peace, Perhaps something came to your mind years ago, but Lord, what about my sins? How thankful I am tonight that all of our sins are where? Cleansed away by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. This cup symbolizes his blood, which was shed for us. How wonderful to know that we do have peace with God, that the sin question has been answered by his grace through his offering, and through his rising again, you and I have life in his name. We can rejoice. We have a message. And at this Christmas time, the people outside these walls need to hear it. There's peace, there's salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. We thank you for this cup. We're thankful for the blood that it signifies. It took away all our sin forever. Bless you, Lord Jesus. And now, as we partake, we ask your blessing upon each one here. In your name, Lord. That night in the upper room, he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Take and drink all of it in remembrance of me. Neville, please come and lead us in our last song.
Will you stand, please, and we'll sing 106, 106. Worthy, you are worthy. King of kings, Lord of lords, you are worthy. 106.
Want to remind us of Jesus' words in John chapter 18. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice. This week, as his children, we want to be carefully listening to whose voice? To Jesus' voice. And let's share with others the wonderful news that Jesus came for them. God bless you, dear family. We'll look forward to seeing you, Lord willing, next week.